Welcome, everybody. Welcome, Comrade Taryn, one of our new young leaders. Comrades, Trump is a nightmare, but there's some silver linings to the nightmare. And one of those silver linings, actually a pretty significant one, if you think about it, is the return of talk and calls for a general strike. I think in the workers' movement in the left, particularly amongst migrant workers in this country and elsewhere, although I've been tracking what's happening in this country, since the inauguration, I've seen no less than a dozen calls for general strikes on Mayday, including ourselves. Several socialist organizations have weighed in on this, but others, and the Village Voice had a front page article on it. Several bourgeois newspapers have had articles on what's going on with this general strike movement. Even businesses have been communicating with each other about what do we do and how do we come down on a general strike, and do we have a right to fire workers, and what does the bourgeois NLRB law say? You know, so it's out there. And of course, there was what I believe is a warm-up to May Day 2017, and that was a day without immigrants just a week ago on February 16th. We've got a good article in the paper on that, and next week there is a day without women, you know, coming out of the Women's March on the 20th. Some of the better elements, not quite as revolutionary as we would like them to be, sort of more centrist, I guess. I hope that's being fair. You know, they call for a what amounts to a women's strike, and it's global in dimension. You know, something like 30 other countries participating about it. And their program's not bad. And, you know, we'll see what will happen on the 8th. I believe there's a scenario for a protest. It's downtown. It's Wall Street. It's they're going to ICE, aren't they, I think? Then there's May Day. And there are many, many calls and now concrete organizing for May Day. I want to put this new interest in a general strike in a communist working class revolutionary context. There's debate in the movement, which is good, over what should you call a general strike? Is it really a general strike? Are workers really going to strike? Can they get away with that? What's the position of unions and so forth? And should we call it something else? A day without immigrants, a day of absence. Shut it down. No business as usual. And I think that all of those terms will be employed, and wisely so, you know, whatever works. But there is some political significance, in my view, to using the general strike, because for communists and revolutionary socialists and those who have based themselves on, you know, the potential of working class power, the general strike represents a high mark in the working class, a more conscious working class, more consciously, independently revolutionary-led working class, flexing its muscles against capital, against the buses, against the bosses, and demonstrating that it is conscious of itself as a class. It's not just this sector striking or that locality striking, which is all good and well. It's all of us trying to strike. And in the old days, the old revolutionary days of the Russian Revolution and the tumultuous period before and after, the general strike was considered a stepping stone toward the revolution. So the term may not be that important. In some ways it's semantics, but in some ways the term isn't important. I'm going to talk briefly on what should happen on May Day, not what will, but what should. And these comments are based on something that the party did a few weeks ago, early in February. We put out a statement, we published it online and in our paper, and it's called something like, Why It's Time for a Global General Strike on May Day. Again, we're not suggesting this is going to happen. We certainly can't organize it. Although we did debate amongst ourselves in preparing the statement whether our party should call for it or whether we should just suggest that it's time. And, you know, we decided to do the latter, suggest that it's time to do it, you know. The global strike is important in our view, putting it out there. Because number one, capitalism in its highly globalized and decaying form cannot be fought country by country, city by city. Of course, that's an inevitable, you know, part of the struggle. Struggles mostly begin locally. Most struggles are local, you know, and we're all down with that. But globalized, highly globalized capitalism can no longer be successfully fought locally. It must be fought globally by a global class of the workers and the oppressed. I underscore workers and the oppressed because that's left out a lot, the oppressed part, you know. And you can see with what Trump's trying to do that leaving that out is a big, big problem. That is why wherever we can, you know, and if we don't remember to do it, remind us. We talk not only in terms of the working class, but we talk of unity between the workers and the oppressed and how to achieve that. Capitalism has to be fought on a global basis. Technology, in other words, the latest state of the means of production makes it far more possible for the revolutionary forces, for anti-capitalist forces, for the working class to coordinate internationally in ways that were unimaginable, just not possible a generation ago. That's important. And this, I think Marx and others were predictive of this as part and parcel of the growth of the means of production and what that meant for the working class on an international basis. But in the immediate sense, all that other stuff is important, very important. In the immediate sense, thinking about a global strike is important now because it is a counter to the neo-fascist, white supremacist, misogynist, capitalist Trump program, which is based on racist nationalism. So to call on our class, the workers and the oppressed, to act globally is a direct answer to him because he wants just the opposite. He wants our class to be fighting each other. And right now, he wants, in a ballpark frame, the workers to be fighting the oppressed instead of fighting capitalism and imperialism. And so we talk about the need for a global strike, regardless of whether it's premature, which we would not argue. Certainly it is premature. We argue for it, and we are passionate and urgent about it and want people to take us seriously because we've got to start thinking in these terms, fellow revolutionaries. We've got to start thinking in these terms if we want to prevent Trumpism to smash the working class into pieces, which is his objective. Another point, and we raised it in the statement we made. In our view, the program of the general strike should, of course, take up all the important economic issues. Wouldn't it be great if there was a general strike around a global wage? you know? So, you know, the capitalists wouldn't be pitting workers against each other based on, you know, take capital here and, you know, lower wages. And all the other issues that the workers and the oppressed have, you know. But right now, it's got to be more than that. The program has to be more advanced. A global Mayday strike, and really any strike, any progressive action, has to be talking about the question of opposition to capitalism and advancing the prospect of socialism. We have to begin doing that. We have to begin doing it systematically. We must reject, in our view, any idea or any notion that talking about capitalism and socialism is over the heads of the masses, that they're not ready for that. The masses are telling us that that's wrong. You can go to some polls that tell you about it, but we don't need to go to the polls. It's how capitalism is tearing apart their desperate attempt to survive on a day-to-day basis. Capitalism is getting more and more unpopular. Why do you think Trump, you know, some wing of the bourgeoisie came up with something like Trump? Because they're so desperate in their effort to divert what amounts to a growing global anti-capitalism and divert it into some kind of racist war that's not only workers and petty bourgeoisie against the oppressed, but maybe at some point on top of a police state, other U.S. imperialist military actions. It's a very dangerous time. We think that now forward, moving forward, revolutionary elements, either as organizations or as individuals, should work together and should advance an anti-capitalist and pro-socialist program openly and strongly. Trump is a product of a global capitalist crisis. Trump is in part, at least a wing, of capital's response to the crisis. What's their response? Trump. So what is our response? Another capitalist party? I think we have to all strengthen ourselves against those forces in the movement who all too often will caution us, don't be unrealistic, don't be too radical. You know, the best thing we can do is get more of these people into Congress and restrain them and so forth. You know, there's space, small space, for that kind of discussion. But we cannot make our program returning the Democrats to power. We might as well lie down and have the capitalists walk all over us. We must answer this capitalist crisis with the only solution that is really realistic, and that is anti-capitalism and socialism.
Right.
Now, to what's arguably practical. What can be done this May Day? And I'm going to talk about in this country. First, I want to talk about the difference in conceptions of a general strike. There is the quote-unquote traditional conception of a general strike. Many, if not most of you, might be familiar with it. And that is that it's something called by the leadership of the trade unions, the leadership of the organized sections of the working class, you know, and they, on the appointed day or days, they organize the workers to shut down their work sites to stay away from work. And this, of course, is tremendous. You know, it stops the means of production, it stops capitalism, and this is celebrated by communists and, you know, all, you know, people who are for the working class everywhere, you see. The problem with that conception, and we've learned this throughout the history of the trade union movement and the communist movement, going back to the turn of the 19th century and the struggles before World War II, you know, and what happened in the Second International and the working class in Germany, and, you know, people like great revolutionaries like Rosa Luxemburg had a lot to say about it. She had a very, she has a very wonderful pamphlet called The Mass Strike. Who's familiar with that? You know, she said, all too often, the leaders of the trade unions, even those who back then called themselves socialists, will shy away from organizing a general strike, saying, well, we're too small, and we need more time. What if we fail? It'll be a catastrophe. It'll be disastrous. And it, some of it sounds very good and thoughtful, but at the end of the day, it amounts to a bunch of excuses not to call a general strike, not to call on the workers and the oppressed and the revolutionary and the progressive forces to do the do, shut stuff down, you see. What Luxemburg pointed out is that this is real. This is not an economic exercise. It's not just an exercise in how many workers are in unions and how many workers can leave work. That's a big part of it. It's a political challenge to the entire working class, regardless of whether they're unionized, regardless of whether they have jobs, whether they're in school, whatever their circumstances may be. That's why she called it the mass strike. This is the popular conception versus a traditional conception of a general strike, not merely based on how many organized workers leave work, but based on the extent to which you can pull greater and greater social forces by the millions and tens of millions into shutting down society. You can do that by shutting down workplaces, but you can also do that by shutting down neighborhoods, by shutting down shopping centers, by amassing so many people that nothing can move, by shutting down transportation, by the students and youth walking out of schools, by stores closing down, by nobody shopping, by just making sure that nothing moves. And this involves everybody. It's not limited. It's not limited to those who are organized and in a better position most of the time. But it embraces everyone. This, in my view, is a much more timely, contemporary, and revolutionary conception for a general strike, whether you want to call it that or shut it down. And, you know, we've seen some examples of it. They're small, but they're big. You know, the taxi drivers in this city that are mostly Arab and Muslim, they had their version of a strike. You know, the shop owners, the Yemeni shop owners, they had their strike against the Muslim ban. And the immigrant workers did the same thing. They did it a few days ago. They did it about 11 years ago, big time. And we think they're going to do it big time on Mayday 2017. I can tell you tonight that all across the country, especially organizations, grassroots organizations that organize and represent immigrant workers, are organizing now for a general strike on Mayday 2017. They're organizing in their communities. They're organizing the youth. We don't even know about it. If you're not in the community, you don't hear about it. They don't need us. Actually, they do need us. I'll get to that. I'll get to that in a point, you know. But they don't need us to organize themselves. When they're angry, when they feel threatened, when they got the feeling and the momentum is there, they know how to do it. Are any of you veterans of that 2006 strike where Lower Manhattan was shut down, where you couldn't move, not a car, not a bus, not a cab, not nothing? They didn't have enough cops, enough of it to control anything. Lower Manhattan was liberated. And let's not even talk about what happened in Los Angeles and San Francisco and in Phoenix and in all over the country. That was truly a general strike. The biggest, the closest thing to a general strike that this country has ever seen. Certainly in 100 or more years. See, they're getting ready for May Day because of this war against communities of color, in particular immigrant workers and immigrant communities, the deportations, the bans, the mass arrests, ICE being given carte blanche. This is a strike against a police state.
Yep.
This is a strike against a racist, fascist police state that is targeting the oppressed. And it's going to be, unless something happens that is unforeseen, and we'll try to understand it and explain it, it's going to be every bit as big as anything that's ever happened, including what happened 11 years ago. See? And what's necessary for us to do, first as a party, but also everywhere in the movement, especially in the movement that is not necessarily based amongst immigrant workers and in immigrant communities, you know, is to sit down immediately yesterday and figure out how we can support this strike. This should be the primary concern, as far as we're concerned, of everyone. Everyone should be thinking about this. One of the biggest challenges that this strike has, and in fact, the movement to be independent of the Democratic Party and the bourgeoisie and be militantly against Trump, is the fact that the Democratic Party, which is organizing very fast on a mass basis, you see those town hall meetings, that the progressive aspect of it, especially if they were, you know, asking, you know, talking about healthcare and stuff like that, you know, but they are trying to benefit from this. They're trying to get back into power based on this movement, and they're trying to choke off its revolutionary potential. This is our biggest challenge, and the challenge has a rotten reactionary aspect in it. It's all rotten, but this one is dangerous. It stinks and it's dangerous. And that is turning the militant anti-Trump movement into an imperialist project against Russia.
Yeah.
And if you watch the media now, you can see that's what they're doing, you know, and, you know, warning. There is a significant section of the U.S. imperialist ruling class that wants to turn all of this into an anti-Russia campaign. We must stop that. It's not that we support the Russian regime. They are capitalists and they are reactionary. However, we are not for the U.S. imperialist ruling class carrying out their imperialist struggle against Russia. That is not in our interests. And it is certainly not in the interests of an independent movement. May Day, sisters and brothers, May Day 2017, and building for and doing everything we can to support this general strike is the best way to counter what the bourgeois opposition to Trump is doing. It deserves repeating. Building May Day, preparing to defend May Day, to defend the immigrant workers and their communities who are preparing to participate in May Day and massifying it. This is the best way in the next 2 months anyway, in the next 2 months, And I'm not leaving out International Working Women's Day, the 8th and the 11th of this month. This is the best way to counter the bourgeois imperialist anti-Trump program. Everybody hear this loud and wide, and let it get out. All of those who are looking for something, what do we do? What do we do? The Democratic Party's got so much money. They got so many talking heads. They're all over the media. MSNBC and CNN are constantly giving them a platform. They're on social media, just like us, except they've got trillions of more dollars, you know? This is how you do it. You build this revolutionary grassroots on the ground campaign to make a general strike on May Day possible and defend the oppressed sections of our class that are preparing to do it. That is the way we answer them. If we do this over the next 60 days or so, we will really have done something important in terms of turning this anti-Trump movement in a revolutionary direction that is away from being absorbed and destroyed by the bourgeoisie. What are some of the things that can be done? We could have a meeting just about that. I was at a meeting last night with representatives from not every immigrant community in New York, because this is a city of immigrant communities. But we had Arab and Palestinian, Muslim, we had Filipino, we had Asian, we had Mexican, we had Central and Latin America, we had African, you know, including, you know, black people, the descendants of black people who were brought over here in chains, you know, and they are organized. They're organizing for it. They need legal defense. They need logistical support. They need numbers from other sections of the working class that are not facing the threat that they're facing. They need significant numbers from other sections of our class to join with them on May Day and before May Day. They need forces that will help them. Let every employer know, large, medium-sized, or small, that if you attempt repercussions against workers who take off on May Day, there will be repercussions against you. Against you. Yeah. That we'll be watching. But we'll be doing more than watching. We'll be organizing. And the oppressed workers, guess what? They're not going to be alone fighting a police state. That's right. We will not let that happen. We will make appeals to the labor movement at all levels. You know, high, medium, and most importantly, the rank and file. We will be instrumental in the organized labor movement at various levels, mostly the rank and file, forming May Day general strike defense committees. And we will struggle with the leadership of the labor movement. And while there may be better things to do, damn it to hell, if we have to have a picket line in front of some central labor council. Amen. To explain why they should be supporting this strike of immigrant workers on May Day, we will do that. It's time to be different. Yeah. It's time to be bold. It's time to be in people's face. There's no time to be normal. See what happened at the State of the Union? See how the bourgeoisie liked his speech? This is the normalization of neo-fascism.
That's right.
This is sick.
That's right.
This is sick. You see, the bourgeoisie, you know, you know, Trump, I said earlier, Trump was their response to the capitalist crisis. So far, it seems like some of them are really, you know, on board with it. Look at the stock market.
Oh my God.
That's a sign that they're saying, hey, racism, deportation, police state, kill more black and brown people, turn people against them, stocks up, that's great. Of course, you know, having the ruling class basically take the reins of government, not, you know, through some intermediate, but, right, you know, just having heads of corporations do it, they like that too. You know, plus, you know, undoing whatever phony, baloney regulations they have on Wall Street, they like that too. So that's part of the reason why the stocks are up. You know, the capitalists, people think they're so smart because they're so rich. That only means that they're thieves.
Right.
They're not very smart and they're not very rational. So they're sort of having an attack of, you know, irrational exuberance. We have an antidote for that. We have an antidote for that. And Mayday's going to be part of that. You know, in New York, which is going to be a big Mayday General Strike Organizing Center, but it's going to be all around the country. I don't think there's any state, any city, in any part of the country that where there's not going to be Mayday strike activity. I don't think so. I don't think so. South, the West, Midwest, East Coast, Mid-Atlantic, New York, you know, even the Southwest, you know. I think this strike is going to be a national strike. Should be global, but let's talk about the national aspect of it. There'll be a lot of building activities. We can organize some building activities. The party can organize some building activities. In New York, we can go out to the boroughs and have pre-May Day rallies where we get out information. And we also get out information on the rights that workers and communities have and the resources that they can turn to if they need them in preparation for the strike. I think that we should get ready for this. One of the things that I hope we can begin tonight, and if not tonight, as soon as possible, is for our party, Workers' World Party, in its own name, to begin forming Mayday General Strike 2017 support committees. Workers' World Party Mayday General Strike Support Committees, where we can concern ourselves with the things that I've mentioned and a thousand things more. I'm not saying that our party is saying that, oh, we're so big and we're so strong that we can take this on a national basis. What I am saying is that one way we can organize our own forces and those new forces who want to work with us is by organizing our own strike support committees. But we will work with other strike support committees. We will integrate and coordinate our activities. This is an important exercise, comrades, because this is how you build a revolution. This is how you plan for bigger and bigger phases of of organized mass confrontations with capitalism and the state. It's a new thing, and some of us know more about it. From what I've observed, the young people really know a lot more than some of us veterans because things have changed. And in some ways, they understand those ways in which things have changed and the way technology has changed things, the role of social media, all sorts of things, you know. So they got a good handle on it. But this is essential experience. I see building for May Day as an incredible experience for the party to see how it can organize itself, people close to it, and then work with others so that there's this new network of support around a nationwide strike. Wow. What an objective. What a revolutionary objective. Imagine what we could learn. Imagine what it might mean for the next phase of the struggle. Anyway, I'm sorry for speaking longer than I'd hoped, but that's the message from the party. By the way, are there people here who would participate in a Workers' World Party General Strike Support Committee? I'll tell you what. You can sign up. right now. You can been signed up right now. And a handful of you comrades right away are going to have to assume responsibility for organizing this committee and calling its first meeting, and who will coordinate with others. There's going to begin a series of Mayday meetings. They may culminate in a People's Assembly to build for Mayday. You know, that's an idea that's out there. You know, maybe after the People's Power Assembly has its huge and important Black Lives Matter protests, not only against Trump but against de Blasio on April 1st, you know, which is 2 o'clock at Herald Square, you know. Anyway, on to a revolutionary May Day general strike. We will demonstrate that the workers will stand with the oppressed on May Day and beyond. Yeah. Pass this around. This is the party's argument for a global May Day and some of the politics in it. It's a good statement. We'll tweak it as necessary, but the politics are very sound. The big thing, amongst many big things, that makes building for a big effort, a strike, that primarily brings out the immigrant workers in the same way that it did 11 years ago, 2006. At another time, not tonight, take too long, it would be helpful both for those of us who are around just to remind ourselves of the role that the party played, because it was not only decisive, but it's just important to know. And also for new people, we played a tremendous role in many parts of the country, on the West Coast and here, decisive. But one of the things that is different is that as bad as things were in terms of repression in 2006, the Trump regime is trying to make it unimaginably worse if they can get away with it, you know. And when you think of the things that are challenges that the immigrant workers are facing as they prepare for May Day, it's the increase in the state and the power of the state, and the fact that the state there's not even a pretense. It's war. It's war against communities of color. It's war against immigrant workers. We do not want this to hurt May Day. You can say, well, what can we do? We have to find ways of fighting it. We have to find ways of fighting it. Among the things that we should do, and this is a healthy thing, whether they realize it or not, for all of the forces that are in motion, you know, the larger forces, primarily white, some say, that they weren't on the scene in the struggle prior to Trump. They thought that things were pretty good and pretty progressive, you know, for some people with Obama, but now Trump is the negation of democracy, and you know there's fear and people freaking out. We want to reach out to those people. They represent significant social forces. There's been a lot of discussion about this in the movement. You know, the meeting I was last night, not all the folks there, but some of them were like, I don't have the time. I just don't have it. I can't explain to some people, you know, what it's like, you know, to worry leaving your house. You know, I don't have time to explain that. I'll organize my people, you know. Everybody else whose circumstances is different, you know, they might as well be on Jupiter or another planet, you know. And it's certainly understandable. But we are struggling as a party to stop the objective of smashing our class into bits and pieces. Our mission in many ways has never been more crystal. Really hasn't, you know. And one of the good things we have that others don't have is they're still feeling around in the dark. They don't know what to do. What do we do? What do we do? We may not know exactly what to do, but we are clear on what our mission is. We will not let Trump and the state smash our class. Not without a huge fight. We'll be right. We'll stick ourselves right in between that. See, there's a lot of things we're going to have to do. Those forces, that new energy, those new social forces, we should come up with an approach to them. What they should be there on May Day, especially the whites. They should be there. We not only have to appeal to the trade union movement. That's important, and we have experience with that. Those new sectors, and all of these people who claim they're progressive, and who either want to run against Russia or are confused by it, and the comments who spoke are so right. This is going to cause a lot of confusion. It's sickening. It really is sickening. You know, talking about letting the Democrats off the hook, and letting the bourgeoisie off the hook, and let them hide behind an anti-Russia campaign. It's disgusting. And there's nothing remotely helpful, enlightening, much less progressive. It's reactionary. It's a pit. It's taking the movement and pushing it over a cliff. And imperialism wins. See, we got a better idea. You're in the Democratic Party, whatever. Whatever you're in this movement, you're in that movement, you're in the women's, bourgeois women's movement, you know. Do what you can, number one, to put pressure on all the bosses. You better not take repercussions against workers who take off on May Day. So they're not just hearing it from us, the revolutionaries, but they're hearing it from other layers in society. You know, you're the establishment, okay, you're supposed to be progressive, do something! You know, politician, whatever. This is how you can help. You send them a letter, you know, or do whatever, you know. And this, the same thing about, you know, just anything that we can do to make it more difficult for the state to manifest the awesome and awful power of its repression in relationship to May Day, and targeting the oppressed workers. There's a lot that can be done. Get more people involved. There should be more calls. You know, trans people in particular are under attack. They have a special role to play, both within the LGBTQ community and as they've been targeted. Let's help get a trans call for May Day. It'll help the entire community, the entire LGBTQ community. They're thinking about it. I bet you prisoners are thinking about it. I apologize. I fell into what most progressive and revolutionary people do. And it's because of the way the bourgeoisie messes with your head about workers. You forget about them. You forget about them. And that's just why they put them in prisons. So that you will forget about them, so that they can do anything they want to them, you know. And I made that mistake, and I'm glad that the comrade brought it up, you know. I bet you there's going to be a strike on May Day in the prisons. And I don't understand how they can bar our paper, but we should find out about that. And we should fight for the rights of the prisoners to read whatever they want, especially our paper, right. You know. Think of ways to broaden this. Think of ways that we can bring in forces that are not already involved. Momentum and activity will do it. It's necessary because we need the unity with the oppressed, but also because the possibility of repression, that bar is higher. And we should be very conscious of that and very serious about it, but not daunted. That just means that we'll fight harder. Thank you. All the socialist organizations, too, should support this. Yeah. And they should say what they're going to do. They should say what they're going to do. It might be important. I mean, it's important for us. I think the party should call for it and should call for others to do it. But all the groups that call themselves socialists, what are they doing to support this? Are they forming committees? Are they seeing what they can do to defend the rights of these workers? You know? I think we've got to make this a movement-wide push on every possible level in any and every way that we can think it. This is a confrontation, and there's a lot at stake.